كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله ولو آمن أهل الكتاب لكان خيرا لهم منهم المؤمنون وأكثرهم الفاسقون.
Assalamu alaikum. Welcome, dear viewers from around the world, to Nation of Goodness. That's the title of our series. Actually, this is the newest and latest series put on by Karim Abuzaid. It's an exciting series. You don't want to miss one episode in this series. Sheikh Karim, thank you so much for joining us, and thank you so much for giving us your insight in addressing this controversial issue of enjoining the good and forbidding the evil.
Jazakallah khairan Malik, and I'm looking forward to talk more about this.
Inshallah. Sheikh, the last episode, we talked about three conditions. This episode, where are we going?
Well, this episode, we want to define things.
Okay.
Definitions.
Definition.
That is the name here, definitions. We said, Amr bima'roof nahi an munkar. Amr, commanding, ma'roof, goodness. What is good? Nahi, enjoining. Or forbidding, or banning, enjoining, stopping.
Right.
What is evil?
Okay.
Let's define those ma'roof and evil first.
Okay. Let's define
ma'roof and munkar.
Good.
First.
We're going to. So in this episode, you want to start by defining good and evil. Who decides what is good and what is evil?
That is a good question, because at the end of the day, in the societies where they live, where we live, or where every Muslim lives now, certain things which is defined by the deen, by the religion, by the Quran and the Sunnah, the sound Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to be good, the society sees it evil.
Right.
But also at the other end of this, something that is evil, the society sees it good.
That's very well put.
Ideal example, what you shared with me before.
Yes, Sheikh, I would like to share that story with you and the viewers. I live here in the Middle East, and actually the power went out in my apartment, and I only had one match left. And my guest said to me, Malik, why don't you have more matches? I said, why? They said, what if you have a guest who would like to smoke a cigarette? I was shocked. I said, of course I would not allow a guest to smoke a cigarette in my home. They said, really, you would tell your guest to leave the house to smoke a cigarette? As if I was like rude. I said, of course I would.
You see,
because this is a cultural understanding.
That is right there. You see, it's a munkar. Somebody who smokes is a munkar.
Yeah.
But because the societal norms, they see it normal.
Right.
Then they see it impolite.
Yes.
If you do something about it.
And then you look like a jerk.
No, you're not. You're actually not. But now how you go about it? You need to educate them. You need to let them know that this is haram. And I'm a Muslim and I'm trying to enforce what is it. But in general, Malik, good, ma'roof, is what is condoned, if this is the right verb, by Allah and His Messenger to be good.
Okay.
Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises the doer of it.
Okay.
And where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards the doer of it.
Okay.
And the top of the line, Malik, of al-ma'roof is al-tawheed. That you believe in Allah. You single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala once it comes to His divine essence, that there is no one is similar to Him, no one is like Him. Once it comes to His actions of lordship, creation, sovereignty, disposing the affairs, and also once it comes to His names and attributes, al-asma wa sifat, so al-tawheed. And then once it comes to His rights, abunyu, al-huwa tawheed al-uluhiyya, that you single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your actions.
Okay.
This is the top of al-ma'roof.
Okay.
And this is what you want people to follow.
Okay.
This is where the area you need to start working on. This is the area where a lot of us need tawheed, taking back people to tawheed. This is the best ma'roof that you can take people to. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala entrusted us with. Okay. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that we are the best ummah for people, we are the best of the people for the people, because we're going to teach them who Allah is. We're going to teach them tawheed. Now, the opposite of this, al-munkar, evil. What is evil? Again, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger identified to be evil, and it is a punishable, or a person, the doer, will be punished. and he will earn sins for doing it. And again, Malik, the top of evil in the face of this earth that we must all shun and try to remove from earth is shirk, people committing shirk, whether shirk in the origin, denying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, people who are atheists, or people who associate with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Father, Son, Holy Ghost, or people who say that Allah begets a son, or Muslims. We have Muslims who go around graves and calling upon the dead. We have Muslims who slaughter, Muslim who pray, invoke human beings,
right.
Invoke sheikhs, imams,
so-called saints.
Yes, saints so-called. For their needs. So this is the top of the line of evil that we must, of course,
remove, inshallah.
Remove. So this is what is good, enjoining good. هذا هو المعروف. This is what is evil. Now, we have an important piece here that we must address is what is the status. And we're going to answer this question. What is the ruling regarding enjoining good and forbidding evil? Is it mandatory? This episode, I would like really to educate the viewers about when you ask this question, what is the ruling?
ما الحكم?
You know, a lot of Sheikh, assalamu alaikum. What is the ruling regarding me doing this and that and that?
And you get this every other day on your
every
program on Gaidas.
On Gaidas TV, I do that show, Let's Talk About It, and mashallah. Now, when you ask this question, the person is trying to figure out, you see, any command in the Quran or in the sound Sunnah falls into one of these five places. Wajib, mandatory, fardu, which means what? You are sinful if you do not do it, and you get rewarded if you do it.
Okay.
Pay attention, dear viewers. This is very important. Two, recommended, meaning what? You are not sinful if you do not do it, but you get rewarded if you do it.
Okay.
Mandub. And this is, by the way, where a lot of people confuse this, because another word for this is sunnah.
And this is a huge confusion. You can do a whole series on this.
Yeah,
actually.
I know.
I
know.
They
messed up the word sunnah. Because sometimes you get a command from the sunnah,
right,
which falls into the area of mandatory. But because of the fact that it was not mentioned in the Quran, it was mentioned in the sunnah. Right. So people say, what? It's a sunnah.
And they say, oh, it's just a sunnah with these bad.
It means it's recommended.
I hate that.
No.
Yeah.
No. You see, sometimes a command was revealed in the sunnah. Like ideal example, اعفو اللحى وقصوا الشارب. A lot of Muslims, they think that not growing the beard is optional.
Right.
It is not optional. It is mandatory.
Right.
But you know why they say it's a sunnah? Because it was mentioned in the sunnah.
Right.
But yet it was mentioned in the sunnah, but it's a command that falls in the mandatory area.
Right.
You see, we take our religion from two sources, Quran and Sunnah.
We have two wahis, we say.
Two wahis.
Not one.
They work together with one. You see, there is a woman who came to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and she said to him, Ummu Ya'qub, her name. Al-Hadith al-Bukhari, Sahih al-Bukhari. Ya ibn Mas'ud, you've been preaching saying, La'an Allahu an-namisa wal-mutanammisa. Allah curses a woman who blocks
her eyebrows.
Eyebrows and the blocked. Where? I opened the Quran from Alif Lam Meem all the way till Al-Nas. I didn't see it. I said, come. And he took her to the verse in Surah Al-Hashr. Where? وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُدُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ. Whatever the messenger commands you, do. And whatever the messenger commands you to leave. That's in the Quran.
Yeah.
So now this gives the platform for the Prophet ﷺ to legislate. Also, we have other verses. وَأَطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولِ. Obey Allah and obey the messenger. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولِ. Oh, you believe, obey Allah and obey the messenger. So now, yet the command is coming from the sound hadith.
It's obligatory.
It's called sunnah.
Right.
But it falls in the obligatory, in the fard, in the wajib area. But a lot of Muslims, they do not do it because they think it's a sunnah, because they associate it with the sunnah, with the definition of sunnah in that context.
Right.
What is sunnah? That if you do not do it, you're not punished. And if you do it, you get rewarded.
Okay.
So those are two.
Thank you for clarifying that.
All right.
Okay, what about the third?
Number three, we have something called permissible, mubah. What is permissible? Sleep, eating, drinking, talking.
Right.
That's permissible.
Neither here nor there.
Neither here nor there.
Yeah.
And it's an act that you do. But you could get rewarded for it if you get an external variable, which is your intention.
Excellent point. Like sleeping on your right side.
Beside, you sleep with the intention of what? To strengthen your body.
Yeah,
I tell you this. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, radiallahu anhu, and Mu'adh ibn Jabal, they were discussing the strategy, each one of them strategy regarding praying tahajjud at night. You see, that's how they discuss. What do you do to wake up at night to pray tahajjud? Abu Musa said, you know what? After I pray Isha, after midnight, I go ahead and do it. Mu'adh ibn Jabal said, I sleep the first two-thirds of the night and I wake up the last third of the night. But he made a very beautiful statement. You know what he said? وَأَحْتَسِبُ نَوْمَتِي كَمَا أَحْتَسِبُ قَوْمَتِي. And when I go to sleep, I have the intention, oh Allah, I'm sleeping to gain some strength in order to wake up for tahajjud. Therefore, you get rewarded for your sleep.
Okay.
So sleep is permissible. But because of that intention, you're sleeping, you're eating, you're drinking. Why? Yeah. Because you want to strengthen your body so you can worship Allah better.
Right.
Look at this. You get rewarded for it. Even so, it's permissible.
Okay.
So.
Mandatory. Recommended.
Recommended, which is mandub. Number three, permissible. We have disliked.
Disliked.
And we have haram. What is disliked? Something that is disliked to do. It is close to haram, but yet is not haram. Even so, a lot of the jurists, they have classified some of it disliked in the area of haram. Some of it is disliked just to keep you away from the haram. But right. We don't want to go into this detail.
Okay.
And there is the haram. So these are the five
categories.
Rulings. Once we ask, what is the ruling regarding enjoining good and forbidding evil?
So where does it fit in? Can we keep the viewers in suspense? And you're going to tell them, inshallah, Sheikh, if possible, in the next segment, where enjoining the good and forbidding evil, where it fits into these five categories?
They have to wait until the break and come back.
Okay, you guys, you heard it from the Sheikh. You guys have to wait. So we'll see you after this short break. Stay tuned.
كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله.
Whispers of Satan. Desires. Peer pressure. Leading you to a dead heart. But there is a way out.
Living hearts.
كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله.
Assalamu alaikum. Welcome back to Nation of Goodness, the latest program put on by Imam Karim Abuzaid. Before the break, he left you guys in suspense. He's going to clarify where enjoining the good and forbidding the evil falls into the five Islamic jurisprudence categories. Say, Karim, you left them in suspense. Now you got to give them the answer.
Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulullah, wa ashadu an la ilaha illallah, wahdahu la sharika lah, wa ashadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasulullah. Let me just introduce something very quickly here. At the end of the day, Malik, at the end of the day, like I said, you as a Muslim have two duties. Duty number one is to worship Allah. You yourself become a servant to Allah. أن تعبد نفسك لله. You're done with that, alhamdulillah. Then now you want to call others to it. We could call this da'wah. This is one.
Okay.
Or you could call it enjoining good and forbidding evil. Either or. You see, those two are, da'wah is
interchangeable.
It's kind of changeable. It's kind of mutual kind of definitions. It's
interchangeable.
Yeah,
the same thing.
But when you say enjoining good and forbidding evil and da'wah, when you use them at the same context, كما قال ابن تيمية لفظ المشترك, something that is a mutual. You really mean two things. Da'wah is to non-Muslims.
Okay.
Who is Allah? La ilaha illallah. Tawheed. Right. You come to the hadith Mu'adh ibn Jabal, hadith ibn Abbas, when he sent to him to Yemen, إِنَّكَ تَأْتِي قَوْمًا أَهْلَ كِتَابٍ. You're coming to the people of the book. Let be the first thing that you call them to is La ilaha illallah. Tawheed. Da'wah. Give them da'wah. That is why when you speak to a Christian and Jew, you're not going to enjoin good and forbid evil.
Right. Excellent point. This is da'wah for non-Muslims.
Yes. Okay. But again, if you see, it's if you mention them at the same sentence, at the same paragraph, if you say, you know what, I'm giving da'wah and I'm enjoining good and forbidding evil. So da'wah then goes to what?
Non-Muslims.
And enjoining good and forbidding evil to what?
To Muslims. That's a wonderful to point, Sheikh. I never thought about it like that.
Yes. But when you say enjoining good and forbidding evil, you could, you know, Ibn Taymiyyah said, إِذَا اجْتَمَعَ افْتَرَقَ وَإِذَا افْتَرَقَ اجْتَمَعَ. When you mention them together, then their meanings are different. And when you mention one of them separately, then they could mean both things at the same time.
Sheikh, can I interrupt you really quickly?
When
to a non-Muslims, we wouldn't call it enjoining good and forbidding evil.
No.
Because their problem is that they don't believe in Allah. So you want to address the problem and give them da'wah,
tawheed. You see, the Prophet ﷺ identified the methodology to approach a non-Muslim.
Okay.
This is a very important point because a lot of our viewers are in the West.
Right.
You see, here is the methodology. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith Abdullah ibn Abbas, fi al-Sahihain, when he sent Mu'adh ibn Jabal to Yemen. Yemen was a Christian and Jewish land. إِنَّكَ تَأْتِي قَوْمًا أَهْلَ كِتَابٍ. You're going to go to the people of the book. لِيَكُنْ أَوَّلَ مَا تَدْعُوهُمْ إِلَيْهِ. Let be the first thing that you talk to them to, you call them to, is La ilaha illallah. You talk to them about Tawheed. Okay. Who is Allah? Because they still believe in Allah, but their concept of Allah is twisted. Right. Allah sleeps, Allah gets tired, Allah has a son, Allah has a wife. Right. You want to refute all of this, you want to stop this and take them to the concept which Islam offers. This is the first thing. Okay. But they drink and they eat and they do what they do. You see...
But this is the bigger problem, is the Tawheed.
The Tawheed, because the Tawheed is the fundamental.
Yeah, right.
Why did Aisha Malik say that? If the only thing that we learned from the Quran in Mecca was who is Allah, Jannah and Hell. Knowing who is the commander. Who is the commander? Knowing his names and attributes. And the reward for you to leave your old ways and the punishment if you don't. So that's what you want to do. You want to talk to them about Tawheed. So this is the methodology of approaching non-Muslims. Non-Muslims.
Okay.
But now once it comes to Muslims, we say a da'wah. I go back again.
Enjoining good and forbidding evil.
No, I go back again.
Okay.
The task, because I want to talk about the ruling, and I'm going to, I hope you're going to cut me off just to give the ruling, because we promised to give the ruling in that segment.
I won't.
So any Muslim, his responsibility is to worship Allah and to call people to it. Calling people could mean da'wah, could mean enjoining good and forbidding evil. Now the Muslims, once it comes to calling people to Allah or enjoining good and forbidding evil, are of two types. Type that possesses the knowledge, like the believer of Ali Fir'aun. وَقَالَ الَّذِي آمَنَ يَا قَوْمِ اتَّبِعُونِ. Follow me, I will teach you. You have the knowledge. This is a student of knowledge. He can sit and teach the people Tawheed, enjoin good and forbid evil through his lectures, through his talks. This is somebody who can do it himself. But a great portion of the Ummah do not possess that knowledge. Do not possess the knowledge to invite people to Allah or to enjoin good and forbid evil.
Right.
Should they stop? No, they cannot stop. They are still required. What should they do? They should do like the believer of Yasin, Mu'min Yasin. What is it? وَجَاءَ رَجُلٌ مِنْ أَقْصَى الْمَدِينَةِ يَسْعَى قَالَ يَا قَوْمِ اتَّابِعُ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. All people, follow the messengers.
Right.
So you direct people. Yeah. If you do not possess the knowledge that qualifies you to call people to Allah, to enjoin good and forbid evil, this does not mean that you're void. No, you're not. Right. Your job, brother, can we go to this lecture? Yeah. Can we go to the sheikh? So you direct people to the scholars. You direct people. You can take a lecture to them. Yeah. You can take a DVD to them. You can take a CD to them. Why this is important, Malik? Why this is important? Before we, you see, I have to furnish this before we talk about the ruling, where the ruling is. Why this is important? Number one, when you call people to Allah, or when you enjoin good and forbidding evil, you're trying to achieve three goals. Goal number one is to benefit the people, remind them.
Of course.
فَذَكِّرْ إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُذَكِّرْ. Remind them. It may be that your reminder will get to them.
Yeah, you may benefit them.
You may benefit them. Your job is to remind them. Your job is to do it, regardless. Your job is to do it. Oh, you remind them. فَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Remind, indeed, the reminders will benefit the believers. So this is number one.
Okay.
That's goal number one you're trying to achieve. So when I see you doing something wrong, I'm reminding you, maybe Allah will place acceptance in your hand and in your heart towards my reminder, and you'll say, you know what, the person, this brother is right, I'm going to just leave it. But this is goal number one. Goal number two, you're trying to take yourself from the area of blame. Why? Because you're going to find out in a minute that when you see evil, you must change it.
Okay.
When you see evil, you must change it. Now, if you do not, you're subject to the consequences of seeing evil and not changing it. What are some of these consequences? You're cursed. You could be cursed. You could be punished. Huh. And we're going to explain this once we talk about the ruling and the consequences if you do not do this. So you're taking yourself out of the area of blame. Remember the people, when we spoke about the people of the Sabbath breaker, huh? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned that part which violated the Sabbath into chimpanzees. But the other part who used to enjoin good and forbid evil, they were what?
They divided themselves, they left.
But they were saved.
Right.
They were not transformed themselves into chimpanzees, rather they were saved.
They took themselves out of the area of blame.
So when you enjoin good and forbid evil, you take yourself out of the area of blame. If you happen that you're going to die, if you happen, you're going to be punished like them, it's a collective punishment and you're going to die. We have Hadith al-Mahdi, a beautiful Hadith for Bukhari, that an army will come out of Iraq, one of the wording will come out of Syria to Mecca, trying to fight al-Mahdi, and Allah will cause earth to swallow this army. They will sink in earth. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, and those people will be raised according to their intention. That some of them are righteous and pious. They had no clue what this army is all about. They just happened to be with this army. They didn't even know what is going on, but they were collectively punished. But you know what? Allah will raise them and will reward them. They are not part of the evil, but they happen to be in the vicinity of the evil. So you're trying to do this. You're trying to do number two, take yourself out of the area of blame. Number three, which is very important, you're trying to establish the evidence against the people.
Elaborate, Sheikh, a little bit.
At the end of the day, Allah is not going to punish you if you don't have the knowledge, if you did not receive a warner. رُسُلًا مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنْدِرِينَ لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ لِلنَّاسِ عَلَى اللَّهِ حُجَّةٌ بَعْدَ رُسُلٍ. The job of the messengers, by the way, they are bearers of glad tidings. If you do this, you get rewarded. And they are also bearers of warnings. If you do not, this is what you're doing is wrong. You're worshipping three. You're worshipping an object. You're not worshipping Allah. This is wrong. Listen, I'm just warning you.
Right.
I'm not just warning. So my job and your job, when we enjoin good and forbid evil, or when we call people to Allah, we're trying to establish the evidence against them. So this is what we're doing. Now, let's go to the point.
Okay.
What is the ruling regarding enjoining good and forbidding evil? Listen, في المسألة نص وإجماع. The issue has clear text, that is, it is mandatory, and inshallah we're going to بإذن الله تعالى shed more light on this the next episode بإذن الله تعالى. And also there is إجماع, consensus.
Okay.
It is mandatory upon every Muslim to enjoin good and forbid evil with the heart.
Without doubt, without question, consensus.
You see, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, if you see evil, change it with your hand, force.
Okay.
Force the change. If you cannot, the tongue, speak.
Speak out against it.
Speak out against it. If you cannot,
hate it with your heart.
Hate it with your heart.
And if you don't hate it with your heart, then you become part of the problem.
Then you don't have iman.
Yeah.
You don't have faith. So they say it's mandatory upon the heart. But a lot of Muslims, they have a misconception regarding this issue. They think that they can still deny it with their heart, and they can still be in the vicinity of the evil.
But this is wrong, and we're going to clarify that, aren't we?
وَقَدْ نَزَّلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الْكِتَابِ أَنْ إِذَا سَمِعْتُمْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ يُكْفَرُ بِهَا وَيُسْتَهْزَوُ بِهَا فَلَا تَقْعُدُوا مَعَهُمْ. Allah has revealed to you in the book that when you see people mocking the ayat, the commands of Allah, making fun of the commands of Allah, don't sit with them until they change. إِنْ حَتَّى يَخُوضُ فِي حَدِيثٍ غَيْرِهِ إِنَّكُمْ إِذًا مِثْلُهُمْ. You're like them. إِنَّ اللَّهَ جَامِعُ الْمُنَافِقِينَ وَالْكَافِرِينَ فِي جَهَنَّمَ جَمِيعًا. Yes, with the heart, but comes with the heart separate. Like the Sabbath breaker, they kept talking to them, advising them, reminding them, they insisted in the evil. I'm sorry, I'm done with you. There's a barrier between me and you. But if I am in the vicinity where the evil is committed, and I want to be with you, I'm going to speak, I'm going to use my hand. Now, it is the ruling. It is mandatory. It is a fard, the first one. Mandatory upon you to change evil, command good with your heart. It is sometimes halal, sometimes haram, sometimes disliked. And this is where really the fiqh comes in. It's actually sometimes it is haram to enjoin good and forbid evil using the hand or the tongue. I know we're going to cut right here, but the next episode is so important. We're going to shed more light on the ruling again regarding enjoining good and forbidding evil.
Thank you, Sheikh Karim, for wrapping it up. And you guys at home, you guys don't want to miss one episode of Sheikh Karim Abuzaid's new series, Nation of Goodness. This next episode is going to be exciting, so you don't want to miss it. Until then, I leave you in the care of Allah. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi
كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله ولو آمن أهل الكتاب لكان خيرا لهم منهم المؤمنون وأكثرهم الفاسقون. كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله ولو آمن أهل الكتاب لكان خيرا لهم منهم المؤمنون وأكثرهم الفاسقون.